How do you explain these group dynamics of people trying to identify as a group with a common enemy, and it's almost cult-like?
Well, look, the way it works, as far as I'm concerned, is that, and I think this is what Solzhenitsyn outlined so well in his Gulag Archipelago when he was trying to account for the murderousness of the Soviet system. You have an idea, a set of ideas, and the ideas have some presuppositions, and those presuppositions, out of those presuppositions, certain logical conclusions necessarily flow. Okay, so once you buy the presuppositions and the identity politics presuppositions are, first, as I pointed out, that the Western culture, especially capitalist culture, but perhaps even democratic culture, is a tyrannical patriarchy, and second, that you should classify people according to their group identity, and third, that history is a victimizer narrative, most appropriately, and finally, perhaps, that social identity is socially constructed. Once you accept those four things, then the entire ideology tends to operate as a deterministic machine. Now, if you're talking to a single person who believes some of those things now and then in the same sort of casual way that people believe most political presuppositions, it's really not that much of a problem, because you're probably talking to a person who's like 95% like everyone else and normal and reasonable and easy to get along with, and 5% committed to their political ideology. But if you get 100 people like that in a mob, then the ideology is complete and it dominates.
Right.
And so then that drives people to all sorts of misbehavior. And so that's part of the problem with mobs, is that they get possessed by their shared belief system, and then everyone acts in a reprehensible manner, and that's what we see happening time and time again. Certainly part of what's happening in the universities.
I want to share an anecdote with you. I got into a discussion online. I shouldn't do that, I know. Some people, they said, you are a angry white male. We've talked about this just before, but I started saying, I'm not white. And it was totally confusing for the people who were arguing with me. And eventually they were making me admit color. So, no, you are white. You have to admit you're white. You have to admit you are of this patriarchy that is suppressing people, etc., etc. And then I said, I'm still not white. You can't call me white. And they were so confused. And eventually I said, I'm Semitic with a migrant background. So I took away them trying to frame me in some, you know, they just wanted to exactly know that they wanted to put me in a certain place. And
yeah.
When I was refusing to do that, they couldn't place me anymore. They were totally confused.
Sure. Well, the thing is that the arguments that are leveled against a person by someone who's primarily playing an ideological game only work if the category structure works.
Right.
So you stepped out of the category structure. But, you know, if they would have been sophisticated, they would have said, well, it doesn't really matter that you're not white. You're male, and that's bad enough. Or you're angry and male. Well, I mean, that's how I would have played it had I been on the other side.
Right.
You know, because you were basically put into three categories, right? Inappropriately angry, inappropriate because you're privileged, and so you don't get to be angry, and anger isn't appropriate anyway. So that's category error number one. White, that's category error number two, and male. And so I would have just said, well, I don't care if you're white. You're white enough for my purposes, but you're also angry and male, and that's enough to make you reprehensible. And one of the things that's so interesting is that, and I really thought about this a lot more deeply, I wrote the foreword to Solzhenitsyn's Gulag Archipelago, the 50th anniversary version, and that's going to be released in a couple of days. And one of the things I realized, and I suppose this is a commentary on intersectionality, although perhaps a critical commentary, is that most people can be parsed into or placed into multiple groups, right? Because each of us has a complex sequence of potential group identities. You know, like you're you have some racial category, some ethnic category, some sexual category, some degree of attractiveness, some degree of intelligence, some kind of class background, some degree of age, and so forth. And so there's multiple categories that can be applied to you.
Yeah, it's like the tree metaphor, right? You have all these roots, and they all of those roots hold the tree together. You know?
Yes, yes. But the thing that's so interesting about that is that what's so terrible about that is that if I'm particularly obsessed, let's say, with the victimizer narrative, and I want to spread that as widely as possible, and I'm talking to you, all I have to do is figure out on which of your group identity dimensions you constitute a victimizer, and then I can make you into the target. And this is what happened in the Soviet Union, is that because people could be categorized in so many identities, it became a race to determine with each person what dimension along which they were a victimizer, and that was always sufficient to have them trotted off to the camps or worse.
Well, I have a background like that. My grandfather was the only survivor of the Holocaust in our family. And it still fascinates me what happened. Why were they perceived as people, the Jewish people, who were victimizing other people and were, punished so badly that they had to be rooted out?
Yeah. Well, part of it is Jews just don't have the good sense to act like a proper minority, because proper minorities are supposed to fail.
Right.
So that's always annoying. And I mean, and there's other complicated reasons as well that I outlined some of them in a blog. I mean, there is a propensity for Ashkenazi Jews in particular to do extraordinarily well in pursuits that require intellectual excellence.
I'm one of those.
And so that tends to place them in positions of, let's say, authority and competence at a rate that far exceeds their proportion in the population. You see the same thing happening to some degree in the United States now with Asians,
very
with
highly achieving
and Japanese and South Koreans, but also with people from India, because they're pulling above their weight, so to speak, demographically.
Yeah.
And that that's a real problem. You see that manifesting itself right now with the scandal that's surrounding Harvard, because it looks like if you were Asian, you had a 50% chance of getting into Harvard in comparison to other people with the same level of accomplishment as you. And so, you know, the truth of the matter is that there are differences in people's ability, and some of those manifest themselves at the group level, and we don't know what to do about that.
Yeah, so, it's very taboo-like. Huh? If you look at some science, there are differences. For the Jewish people, it's easily to explain. You know, we were prohibited to do a lot of things. So they had to excel at the things they could do, you know, and that has developed in centuries, over the centuries. But
in the Asians in the U.S., they seem to do better primarily because of an enhanced work ethic. So I reviewed the literature on Asian accomplishment in junior high and high school.
So you're saying achieving is a cultural thing also?
Oh, definitely. What happens to Asian Americans is that the children of first generation Asian Americans overperform, and that starts to disappear by the second generation, and by the third generation, it's gone completely. So as the Asian American immigrant children, let's say, become more like Americans, the differential in their performance vanishes.
Okay, very interesting. Your book, 12 Rules for Life. You say you fight chaos, and this is like your handbook for fighting chaos.
I provide an antidote rather than fighting it, let's say.
okay.
Right. So, you know, and I'm doing that by helping people try to find meaning, sort of sustaining meaning in their life. And a lot of that is a consequence of voluntarily accepting responsibility.
And it's about the individual. It's about individualism. You know?
Yes. Well, it's about the individual. It's not exactly about individualism, because I believe that the proper category for a human being is the individual.
Right.
But it isn't exactly individualistic, because my sense is that if you conduct yourself properly, you take care of yourself, but also your future selves. And so that's a kind of community right away. You know, because, for example, even though you're relatively young, you have to act in a way that hopefully allows you to set aside something useful for the old you. And so that means there's a community involvement element, even if you're only taking care of yourself properly. But although the focus of categorization should be the individual, if an individual is acting properly, they act in a manner that's of benefit to them, but also of benefit to their family and also of benefit to their community.
Yes.
And so it's more like a relationship of harmony across levels of existence than something that's focused on like the happiness of the individual. I'm more interested in meaning and, well, as I said, meaning and responsibility. And there's definitely a communitarian element to that, even though I think the conceptual, the proper conceptual level fundamentally for people interacting with each other is individual to individual.
Right. Yeah.
It's partly because only individuals can feel pain. Right. So in some sense, the group is a fiction because a group can't bear responsibility.
It's not one breathing organism.
No, it's not. And it's fluid across time, and it doesn't have a memory. It doesn't have a cohesive, structure. And so it's heterogeneous. It's deeply heterogeneous in its structure. You know, I mean,
and these groups make us very tribal. You've talked about this, right?
Yes,
tribal behavior, which means,
means violence.
Yeah. Barbaric behavior.
Yeah. Tribal. I mean, anything that pushes us closer to the bounds of regression into tribalism, which is a very, very easy thing to precipitate, is very likely to increase the probability of intertribal violence.
Why are humans so receptive to group behavior? Why is that?
Well, we're unbelievably social.
Yeah.
You know, we're unbelievably cooperative. I mean, and the flip side of that is that, you know, we cooperate within groups that we've managed to organize, but that tends to set us at odds with other groups.